everybody, and welcome to everybody watching on our Facebook live feed. This is our annual Blue Christmas, or longest night service. I'm going to explain it a little bit more in my message, but from what I understand from the scientific standpoint, on this day of the year, the northern half of the Earth, the northern hemisphere, is at the farthest point tilted away from the sun. And because of that, we have more darkness tonight than any other night, and between now and the spring, it'll start to tilt back. So on this longest, coldest, not coldest, but longest night of the year, we gather to shine the light of Christ. I want to thank my friend and my brother Ron for being the lay leader tonight. I wanted him to come as Elvis because it's Blue Christmas. He did not do that, but I told him he was dressed well, and he said, thank you very much. So thank you very much, Ron, for being here. Thank you for our people that will be singing to us, Amanda Lavery and Heather France. And thank you for Derek, who did not know 10 minutes ago that he'd be our clicker guy for the PowerPoint. But thank you for that. So this is a service for everybody. You don't have to be having a miserable day. You don't have to be depressed. I'm a Bears fan, so I'm kind of in that category. You could just come here to pray. This is a crazy time of the year. How many of you can think of multiple things you have to do before Christmas? It's just nuts. The kids tear everything off, and 2 minutes later, everything's over. And we've done all this work, all this prep, all this cooking. So if anything, this is just kind of a restful checkoff point. So Derek, if you want to go ahead and advance, I'm gonna do our call to worship. I'm gonna click the slides. Oh, that's the laser.
What?
That's the laser pointer. The arrow buttons.
There you go. I didn't really give him a lot of training. That's my fault, Derek.
Okay.
All right. So the next one, we're on the call to worship. If you want to click one more, it goes right along with the bulletin. There we go. Okay. So let me read this to you, and then we are going to speak in unison, and then we're going to sing In the Mid-Bleak Winter. And this night is the mid-bleak winter, literally, is what this night is. So many in this season are ready to sing joy to the world, whether this is the first Christmas without someone we love, or we are still hurting from a loss, or we've been suffering for a long time, we gather this evening as darkness comes to worship God in the midst of mourning. We gather to shed tears if they come, to hold hands if they are available, and to join our voices with one another and our forebearers in faith who still cry out, how long? And so we pray. Would you say this with me? Come, Holy Spirit, comfort us and all who mourn this night. Give us strength to grieve as we must. Help us receive your healing in the midst of our pain and find new order after the chaos of loss. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our opening hymn is in our hymnal, in our pew, the United Methodist hymnal. It's number 221, and it's also on the slides. And thank you, Derek. If I had told Derek he was doing this an hour ago, he might not be here right now. So thank you so much for doing that, Derek. I appreciate it. Let us stand as we're able and sing 221 in the mid-bleak.
Thank you.
name the losses we have suffered. Can we say this in unison? We name our losses before God, the loss of a partner in life, the loss of a well-loved family member, the loss of a friend, the loss of a loved one, the loss of a pet, the loss of health, the loss of a shared dream, the loss of self-confidence. We name our own particular losses in silence before God. Moments of memory, the good ones and the hard ones, and we reflect on the feelings that have been ours and lost. We pause and remember and reflect.
Feel free in the silence of these moments to take a few minutes to just be silent, to breathe, and to connect with God. Struggling with high fuel prices and gas prices and inflation. Some of us have lost family and friends. Some of us are watching in horror at the war in Ukraine. Some of us maybe will be able to see family and friends this year. Maybe we haven't in a long time. Some of us maybe have lost jobs. What I said this past Sunday, because we had a special lunch here for Kyle Westcott and all the folks from Great American, is there's a lot to be afraid of right now. In the 5 years I've been here at Sydney, we've lost Kmart, Great American. We've had a lot of things decline. But hope is stronger than fear. And we come on this longest night of the year to not only to put our hope in the light of the world, Jesus Christ, but to also put our hope in each other. My beautiful wife was here on Monday night, and she helped up here to write the word hope. So what we have the opportunity to do, if you want, these are tea light candles. There's little buttons on the bottom. Ron doesn't trust me with real fire, so we have these. And if you want, in just a moment, you can come forward and light a candle, or not. You can light three candles if you want. And in doing so, you can speak out loud, if you want, something that's on your heart, something that you want to release to God. The first one I want to speak for is the war in the Ukraine. Last time I checked, which was this morning, there are hundreds of thousands of Russian casualties, 300,000 or 400,000. Infrastructure in Ukraine has been destroyed. We have brothers and sisters without running water or power or heat. People have been dying. People have been killed. Human rights violations. So tragic. I light this candle for our brothers and sisters in Ukraine. And I light this candle for all the people in Sydney and the Tri-Town area who are suffering, who are battling addiction, who on this Christmas have very little to give to their children, and people that are just struggling in general. I did not mention it, and I forgot to make a sign, but if anybody wants to give that basket, the money from that will go to Ukraine Relief through UMCOR, the United Methodist Committee on Relief. But friends, as you're so moved, come forward if you'd like. Light a candle and speak out loud what God has put you on your heart, or don't. So once you come, I'm just going to turn the heat up real quick. Once you come and light a candle.
Sarah, I know your husband, my brother, Christ Gary, went home to be with the Lord almost 3 years ago. So I let this for him. Any others?
Jesus is the light of the world, and on the darkest night of the year, the light of Christ fills us all. Let us say together, as we have in the Christian tradition for 2,000 years, let us say the prayer that's in our bulletin and also on our screen, the Lord's Prayer. Let us say this together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We're very blessed again tonight to have Amanda Lamory and her Aunt Heather come sing to us the sweetest gift. Thank you so much. blessing you are to our church. Thank you so much for sharing your gift of music and your love of the Lord. Ron, thank you for reading scripture tonight. I appreciate it very much.
The Old Testament reading tonight comes from the book of Psalms, chapter 80, verses 1 through 7. Give ear, O shepherd of Israel, you who leads Joseph like a flock, you who are enthroned upon the cherubim, shine forth before Ephraim and Benjamin and Manasseh. Stir up your might and come to save us. Restore us, O God. Let your face shine that we may be saved. O Lord God of hosts, how long will you be angry with your people's prayer? You have fed them with the bread of tears and given them tears to drink in full measure. You make us scorn of our neighbors. Our enemies laugh among themselves. Restore us, O God of hosts. Let your face shine that we may be saved. The New Testament scripture reading tonight comes from the book of Hebrews, chapter 10, verses 32 to 39. But recall those earlier days when, after you had been enlightened, you endured a hard struggle with sufferings, sometimes being publicly exposed to abuse and persecution, and sometimes being partnered with those so treated. For you had compassion for those who were in prison, and you cheerfully accepted the plundering of your possessions, knowing that you yourselves possessed something better and more lasting. Do not, therefore, abandon that confidence of yours. It brings a great reward. For you need endurance so that when you have done the will of God, you may receive what was promised. For yet in a very little while, the one who is coming will come and will not delay, but my righteous one will live by faith. My soul takes no pleasure in anyone who shrinks back, but we are not among those who shrink back and so are lost, but among those who have faith and so are saved. This is the word of God for you, the people of God. Thanks be to God.
The word Emmanuel means God with us. This classic hymn that we've probably sung many times, I think taken from an Israeli tune, if I understand, or a Jewish tune, is the call for God to come amongst us and save us. Let's stand as we're able and sing 211, O come Emmanuel. And thanks again, Derek, for being the clicker.
Oh God.
our church and in many churches throughout the centuries. We stand for the gospel because these are the words of or attributed to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the light of the world. We're going to be reading a short reading tonight, John 16, 31 to 33. It's in page 105 in the New Testament of your pew bulletin. It's on the screen. You can use a Bible at home or you can follow along. This is what it says from John 16, 31 to 33. Jesus answered them, "Do you now believe? The hour is coming, indeed it has come, when you will be scattered, each one to his home, and you will leave me alone. Yet I am not alone, because the Father is with me. I have said this to you, so that in me you may have peace. In the world you face persecution, but take courage, I have conquered the world." Once again, the word of God through the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. So, Blue Christmas or Longest Night. For those that have never come to one of these services before, let me read to you a description from one of our United Methodist websites, and this is what it says. Blue, yes, blue is in the blues, as in I'm feeling blue. Not everyone is up and cheery for the Christmas holiday, dealing with the death of a loved one, facing life after divorce or separation, coping with the loss of a job, living with cancer, some other disease that puts a question mark over our future, and a number of other human situations make parties and joviality painful for many people in our congregations and communities. There's a growing attentiveness to the needs of people who are blue at Christmas. Increasing numbers of churches are creating sacred space for people living through dark times. Such services as these are reflective, accepting us where we really are, and holding out healing and hope. Some churches hold a service of worship on the longest night of the year tonight, which falls on or about December 21st, the winter solstice. There's an interesting convergence for this day, as it's also the traditional feast day for St. Thomas the Apostle. This linkage invites us to make some connections between Thomas's struggle to believe Jesus' resurrection, and the long nights just before Christmas, and the struggle with darkness and grief faced by so many of us living with loss. And as I said, this is the winter solstice, also known as midwinter, and this is the day that is the shortest night of the year. Well, with that said, as I said before we lit the candles, I was reflecting as I was getting ready tonight, knowing that we didn't have multiple COVID restrictions. We didn't have to air high five. Nobody's here in space suits. We didn't have to cover ourselves with a gallon of hand sanitizer. But we've still been through quite a lot. We've had a lot of losses in the past 3 years. Maybe we've had losses in our own lives. We certainly have had losses in our communities. We've lost businesses. We've lost loved ones. Some people have lost jobs. We still struggle in this community with a drug problem and domestic violence and all kinds of other things. It would probably be so easy for us some days to just say, the heck with it all. Any of you had a day lately where you just did not want to get out of bed because you knew your bed was safe and warm and the rest of the world might be a little scary out there? Maybe tonight you're asking yourself the question, what now? The pandemic supposedly is at bay, is what we're being told, but our hospitals are flooded with flu and RSV and some COVID. There's a war raging in Ukraine, and we might be asking ourselves, where's the human decency? Where's the kindness? Where's the love of Jesus? And that's why we come tonight, friends. We come tonight because this is the longest, darkest night of the year. And if you're feeling grief, if you're feeling brokenness, or if you're not feeling those at all, we can come together to love each other. What I love about the Sydney United Methodist Church is this is a place where the love, the light, and the life of Jesus shines. And you can come here and you can feel that and you can be part of something. It's so easy when we put all of our lights together, like around this table, the darkness flees. We are stronger together. During the pandemic, we had to quarantine. We had to isolate ourselves from each other. I hope now we realize that we can come back to church. We can come back into relationship with each other. I'm not going to say that I haven't struggled some days too. There have been some nights I've gone home to my wife and I've said, I think Sydney in the Tri-Town area is done for. Anybody ever have those feelings? As of late, most days I don't feel that way. But just in the 5 years I've been here, we've lost stores, we've lost so much. But you know what's still here? And I said this on Sunday. We have so many amazing people in Sydney and Unadilla and Bainbridge and all around. We have so many incredible people that are kind-hearted and are loving, and hope and light defeat fear. In John's Gospel, chapter 1, verse 5, which we'll be reading on Christmas morning, it says, "The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overtake it." Our scriptures for tonight from Psalm 80 and Hebrews and John all talk about struggle and all of these things. I think if I had to say the best thing for us going forward, what now, is for us to live and love each other together. I have told this story in church and to many people times before, but the first week when I was in seminary school, 2010, back when I knew everything, I remember it was the first week of school, and our seminary professor gave us an assignment. We all groaned. He said, "Don't worry, you don't have to turn it in." But he said, "What I want you to do is go home this week, and when you get some time, I want you to drive around, walk around, bike around. And I want you to see what the neighborhoods and the community that you do ministry in looks like. Whether you're a chaplain, a pastor, volunteer, I want you to go around your community. In a community like this in Sydney," and this was late August, early September, "I just want you to observe it." And what he said, "You're probably going to see people mowing their lawns, people washing their cars. You're going to see kids playing. You're going to see people gardening." And then he said, "You'll probably see some of these things and maybe some not good things." And then he said, "Then I want you to go home and I want you to sit in a room that's kind of darker. And just sit there for maybe 20 minutes. And I want you to think about and ponder what you don't see. I want you to think about and ponder what's behind the doors. What's not out in front of you. Where the lawnmower isn't. And what you might see, if you could see, is you're going to see people that are struggling with loss. People that are crying themselves to sleep. People that are victims of domestic violence. People right here in this community right now that are shooting up with hypodermic needles. You're going to see all of these things if you could really see through those walls. And friends, on this longest, darkest night, this blue Christmas, this is why we need the light of Christ. Jesus didn't come just to complete a transaction on a cross. He revolutionized and changed the world. His kindness and his love is baked into our culture. And as I'm going to say on Christmas Eve, this is why we're so much nicer on Christmas Eve and Christmas Day. Maybe somebody really ticked us off on Christmas and we gave him a pass because it's Jesus' birthday. I don't even get a pass on my birthday. But the love of Christ has transformed our culture. Whether our culture realizes it or not, we have suffered a lot of loss in the past few years. I remember, and I was thinking about it when the service started, it was early January of 2020, Ron remembers that, I found out that COVID had somehow gotten into our church. Ron and I both had to go home. Sarah went to the hospital, as did her husband, and all of a sudden I'm in the parsonage doing church. I had never done that before. I get a call all of a sudden from one of our beloved members, Peggy Stilson, as we now at that point had 5 or 8 people that we knew had COVID. This is, of course, before vaccines. And Peggy said, "Sarah just went to the hospital in an ambulance." And I literally shrieked and fell on the ground and started crying profusely. My lovely wife, Melissa, ran downstairs and she said, "What's wrong?" And I said, "My people are suffering. And I want to take their suffering and I want to put it in me. And I want to make it so that they don't suffer and I suffer in their place." And those were two of the longest weeks of my life as people went through COVID. Sarah ended up being in the hospital for a while. And for 6 months, we happily were her taxi service. Instead of driving Miss Daisy, we drove Miss Pressler. And we were so happy to do that. I remember during that time, I told our church leaders, "I'm happy to take responsibility for this and resign my position if necessary." And after telling me I was crazy, they said, "Why would you do that?" I said, "Because I just feel so powerless. I feel so broken that some of the beloved people in my church were sick and I couldn't do anything to fix it." And maybe tonight you feel that way on some level. Maybe the loss of a loved one. Maybe some other problem in your life. Maybe you're lonely. Maybe you wish you had more company. And oh, friends, oh, how I'm so blessed to have this church. Not just because I'm the pastor, On January 1st, my wife and I, we're going to come here and worship, and I'm going to be a guy out in the pews. I love being here because the people here love each other. They accept each other. And in a world that has so many problems, how many places really exist like that? How many places, it's like the show Cheers, where everyone knows your name, but we don't have a bar, right? How many places are like that? There's so much fear and anxiety out there. How many of you, by a show of hands in the past month, have had some fear or anxiety? Jesus is the light of the world. He's the hope. I've read the book, and I've read the ending. And you know what the ending says? Vladimir Putin doesn't get the glory. Kim Jong-un in North Korea doesn't get the glory. The people that are abusers and harmers and crooks and robbers and these people that still try to sell me an extended car warranty, they don't get the glory. Jesus Christ gets the glory. Mercy and righteousness and hope and faith will win if the light of Christ is in us, and it's stronger when we're together. Jesus created the church just not so we could sit here and listen to a sermon and music, so that we could love each other deeply and boldly. And on this longest night of the year, friends, may we shine the light of Christ in ourselves out into Sydney and the world, because it desperately needs it now more than ever. If we feel discouraged, get with a brother or sister in faith and encourage each other. There are times I get discouraged. Once in a while, I'll go home to my wife and I'll go, the world's going to heck in a handbasket. And then the next day, I might go home and go, I am the best pastor in the world. And she'll go, well, luckily you don't have an ego about it. I think we all have these times. We all have these moments. Another shooting on the news, another event, another thing like that. All of this goes on, and Jesus is still the light of the world. The solution to the world's problems is Jesus, and in addition, Jesus in us. When we love people, when we care for people, when we do great things in Sydney and the world, that's when the world looks like Jesus. And that's what we're called to do on this longest night, this blue Christmas, and always. Amen. Well, friends, as we prepare to come to the table of the Lord for the Lord's Supper, Holy Communion, in the United Methodist Church, everybody is welcome at the table. Everybody's welcome for Holy Communion. I have bread here, and I have juice. I asked my wife, she went to Price Chopper one day, to get me a small loaf of bread. That's a small loaf of bread, apparently. I think it's about the size of a taxi cab, but she said they didn't have small loaves of bread. We also have disposable ones up here. We have gluten-free, and we have regular. The point of communion is to draw us closer to Christ, who is the light of the world. And without Jesus, without the light, what do we really have? So with that said, the joke I have all the time is Methodists, we do two things well. We sing and eat. We're about to eat of the bread and the cup. So we're going to sing Bread of the World. You can stay seated for this, 6:24. Thank you to Derek, our clicker guy. Let us sing Bread of the World as we prepare to come to the table of Jesus Christ. Confirmation class meeting that we're doing, I showed our confirmands a video about all the different kinds of Christianity. And I think their heads were spinning at the denominations, Baptist, Episcopalian, Roman Catholic, Methodist, etc., etc. One of the things that's united Christians over the centuries are basic statements of faith. These statements of faith don't say anything about the political party you're in, whether you're a Ford or Chevy person. They're basic understandings of who we say God is, basic understandings of our understanding of Jesus and the Holy Spirit. On this night, as we're able, it's on the screen, but it's also 882 in your hymnal. Let us say together a statement that's been said for well over 1,600 years, the Apostles' Creed, in this case, ecumenical version. Let's say this together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the universal church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. When I was a little boy in Illinois, once in a while we'd go to Grandma's house after church. Grandma would get out all the fine china, the white tablecloth, and one time I jumped in puddles, and I went to go sit at Grandma's table, and I felt like an eagle talon, which was her hand grabbing me, saying, "You better wash up before you come to the table." It's only proper that we confess our sins to God before we come to the table. And there's one I have. Sarah and Ron thought this was pretty funny at the time. It was the week of Thanksgiving, and our phone was ringing off the hook. And I swear somebody was paying people to call with completely crazy and absurd questions. Some of the things they were asking were crazy. Even Sarah, good Christian woman, rolled her eyes at one point. I think I got the last call in the batch, and I walked in the office, and Sarah and Ron were in there and said, "You know, I used to really struggle with the Noah's Ark thing, but I might flood the earth today if I was God." And they just busted out laughing. So we all have these moments where we lose our temper, or where we, something happens. We love it when people cut us off in traffic, don't we? Right. So it's a daily journey to be more like Jesus. Our prayer of confession is responsive. It's 8:93. There will be some time to reflect and talk to God individually, and I'll speak words of hope, and then we will partake of Holy Communion. So let us go through 8:93 together, and you read where the bold print is. Lord, we confess our day-to-day failure to be truly human. Lord, we confess to you. Lord, we confess that we often fail to love with all we have and are, often because we do not fully understand what loving means, often because we are afraid of risking ourselves. Lord, we confess to you. Lord, we cut ourselves off from each other and we erect barriers of division. Lord, we confess to you. Lord, we confess that by silence and ill-considered word, we have built up walls of prejudice. Lord, we confess that by selfishness and lack of sympathy, we have stifled generosity and left little time for others. Holy Spirit, speak to us. Help us listen to your word of forgiveness, for we are very deaf. Come fill us this moment and free us from sin. Friends, in the silence of these moments, go before Almighty God with whatever on your heart and ask him for forgiveness, and you will have it.
Dear friends, God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
Yes.
If you go before Jesus, you're forgiven, not because I say so. You're forgiven because he says so. Tonight I'm going to do a very basic communion. I'll offer it to Ron and Sarah. Ron is going to help me with it. This is the very small loaf of bread that Melissa got She's on her way home from work, so I'm giving her a hard time because she's not here. But in that upper room, the night before Jesus died on the cross, in addition to the normal Passover dinner that he shared with his friends as good Jews, he took bread, grain from the field, and he lifted it. He asked God to bless it, and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body broken for you." When I was a little boy, Melissa and I went to a Methodist church, and I was like 5, and I said to my mom, "It's amazing how that pastor splits the bread perfectly every month." But what I didn't realize was they had cut it all the way down to the crust. I just thought the pastor was that good. When the supper was over, Jesus took the cup, he lifted it, he asked the Heavenly Father to bless it, and he said, "Friends, this is the blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many. My blood sets you free. Love God and love your neighbors. Shine the light of the world out in Sydney, the Tri-Town area, and everywhere." Would you pray with me? Almighty God, we thank you for these gifts of bread and juice. We ask that they become to us spiritually the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, that in partaking of them, we might grow closer to you, closer to each other, and closer to the light that is your Son. In your name we pray. Amen. And Ron and Sarah, or I can come to you if you want, Sarah. Friends, won't you come? Everybody's welcome at the table of Jesus Christ. We also have sealed communion cups if you can fill that.
Lord God, we thank you for this gift of bread and cup. We thank you that Jesus offered it to us as a constant reminder that through it we are connected to you deeply, that we're connected to the love of your Son, and in partaking of it, the life, the light, and the love of your Son fills us, and may it fill us more so that we might bring it out into the world very soon. In Jesus' name, amen. A hymn that I love, it's in the Faith We Sing, or as I like to call it, the Skinny Hymnal. It's 22:26. It's very short. Maybe we can sing this together. The Church of Jesus Christ, whatever the denomination, is called to be bound together in love. And when we're bound together in love and light and life, it shines bright even on the darkest night of the year. Let us stand as we're able and we'll sing 22:26. Bind us together.
Thank you.
not overtaken. The light of Christ is in you. Shine it individually and shine it together. What a blessing it is to be with you on Blue Christmas, this longest night. Be blessed this night and always in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Would you pray with me? Lord God, we thank you for this stop-off point, this sort of religious truck stop, if you will, in this season, where we can stop off and tend to our hearts, tend to our souls. We thank you for the opportunity to gather, to light candles, to sing, to break bread and cup together. We ask you to bless us and have your light fill us as we leave. And if we continue to feel blue, may we know that there are places like this where we can be renewed, filled with love, and connect to your Son in new and powerful ways. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And to end the service, this is my favorite part because I'm a touchy-feely person. Let us share with each other as we move to choir or depart the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ by shaking hands, fist bumping, hugging, or whatever the young kids are doing now. Let's go ahead and do that.